Welcome to the God Academy podcast.
Hi, everybody. Hello, Rutger, Dr. Rutger Vos.
I was wondering what would be your shtick now. That was a good one. That was a good one. Simple and effective. Because today, in this new Science in Movies podcast, we're going to talk about epidemics.
Yeah. Roads. Where we're going, we don't need roads.
It's going airborne.
Well, we used to look up in the sky and wonder at our place in the stars.
And in movies, that's always the cue, right? When somebody starts going, then you know, okay, it was nice knowing you. Next scene, you have tubes running out of your body, probably.
I think I'm getting the black lung, Bob.
Unless you are Dustin Hoffman's opposite romantic interest, then... Oh. You are the catalyst that allows him to save the world. So this brings up to the movies we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about Outbreak and Contagion, mm-hmm. which both represent pandemics. That's what it's called?
Yes. Pandemics are just really big epidemics that go worldwide. They're all pandemics.
All pandemics. So
what we're talking about are pandemics.
Okay, so Outbreak and Contagion, those are diseases that humans contracted from animals. Or is it just like the imagination of the next global epidemic? That's the topic. That's the rubric where you would put it.
Both these movies show the medical professionals and they show them succeeding in a race against time. I think that's what they have in common. And they try to depict it semi-realistically.
Okay, so we're going to fact check those movies very soon. And we are going to talk about Philadelphia, the Tom Hanks, Denzel Washington movie about the former deadly disease of HIV/AIDS.
Mm-hmm. Didn't you have an obligation to tell your employer you had this dreaded, deadly, infectious disease?
Which I guess is not so deadly anymore. And last and definitely not least, Black Death. Which is three guesses. Let's give our listeners three guesses to guess what disease does Black Death depict.
Is it typhoid?
No. The Black Death. Concentrate.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry, guys. Sorry.
So you have something general to tell us about epidemics? To kick things off before we go into Outbreak, I want to start with Outbreak.
They are, in the present day and age, always viruses. They are viruses that are not very well adapted to us. They have no interest in making us sick, and especially not in killing us, right? Mm. Because we are the host, we are the replicators. The host, right. And so when these...
Yeah, I was wondering about that, okay.
Yeah, they have a little bit of interest in making us a bit under the weather, right? So... For example, in the interest of some viruses, it's good if you start sneezing a little bit on people around you and stuff like that, right? That just spreads the viral particles. So that's good, but if you die, that's not good at all. And actually, the more lethal diseases are the ones that have jumped hosts more recently, right? Because they have sort of co-evolved with another host, another animal.
Okay.
And then they end up in us, and then there's not a good working relationship between the two of us, and it starts killing us. And it's no good for anybody involved.
First of all, we need a moment of silence for the viruses. Yeah. They are also the victims here.
They also, yeah.
But this brings us to Outbreak and Contagion. We can talk about those two together. Mm-hmm. So these global epidemics, there's a very big difference in the 1990s version of this global epidemic and the 2011 global epidemic. Mm-hmm. In the first one, it's not really global in the 90s. It's like a small town in rural Indiana or something like that.
Might as well bomb it, you know? Who gets the
fuck? Yeah, why are you guys trying so hard?
That option was on the table. Was just airburst explosion above them. Nobody's going to miss them.
I say we take off and nuke the entire site from orbit. It's the only way to be sure.
Fucking A.
And I was thinking about the scene about the army taking over the town would go over today in cinema when you like
The like the government is coming in, taking over a town.
The FEMA camps. That's it, right?
Yes. Yeah, that was it.
Military have escalated the quarantine at Cedar Creek, doubling their presence in the small town. Authorities remain silent about the numbers and details of the situation, continuing the media blackout.
So basically, it started from a monkey, a virus that was all of a sudden was able to contract us with a disease.
Yeah.
And it's the same with Contagion. We find out at the end that it's a bat and pig combination that through some kind of mutation hurt us. So both cases, it's the animal industry that is killing us. And that is realistic.
Yeah, that is realistic. Yeah, good point. Yeah.
The mad cow disease, H1N1,
yeah.
All those.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Are living with these other animals and exploiting them in their vicinity in general makes these diseases jump, and it has had enormous effects on the whole course of history with these zoonoses, is actually what they're called, so diseases from other animals.
Mm.
They've had enormous effects, for example, because there was many more livestock in the old world, cows, pigs, sheep, etc., etc., with their diseases than there were in the new worlds, where the Native Americans only had like llamas, alpacas. That's actually the only hoofed animals that they had. And so when the Europeans discovered, quote unquote, the new world, they brought in these diseases that they had immunity to already because of the much longer interaction.
Yeah.
But the pre-Columbian populations in the Americas had not, and many, many, many of them died because of that.
Yeah. Even more than the actual Black Death in the 1300s.
In absolute numbers, yeah.
Yeah. Also, I think in percentages, not like 90% of them died or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah.
It's crazy. How realistic and scientifically viable are those two movies in terms of how you deal with disease? How do you find a cure and all that? Science guy.
I thought Contagion was very realistic. I thought it was interesting to see some of the facilities that they use, and actually in both these movies, they accurately portray this biosafety level stuff, these labs that are like level 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
And even in Contagion, at some point they flash some stuff on the screen where they have built a kind of a family tree of the disease, phylogeny, which is something that I work on as well. And they show the genes that are involved, and they show these database identifiers of the genes. And I checked, I put them in the database in a query, and they used actual data. They did pretty good research, so that was nice. And that was better than Outbreak, which, I mean, there are some Deus Ex Machina here and there, which was kind of weak.
So Contagion, like they already had Outbreak come out, right, like 18 years before, and they already know and understand that every single person watching this movie knows what the movie is about. So there's no point in waiting so long before something actually happened and people actually realize that there's a disease. In Outbreak, there was like 30 minutes of the monkey going this way and that way, and nobody knows what's going on, and you're like, don't you know that you're all going to die? So I guess in 2011, they just realized that now we're a smarter audience. We've seen the previous movie. It's basically the same thing. So they modernized it and also had implications, social implications, economic implications, political implications, which I thought were done very thoughtfully, very realistically.
Both of these movies, and actually the others as well, say something about how we process actual pandemics or the risk thereof. Like, first of all, we really have a blind spot for the impact of diseases. You know, when we were doing the preparation for the movie, we were like, okay, Contagion, Outbreak. And then it took a while for me to dawn on me that we should obviously do something about AIDS as well. I think what we as people in general tend to do is try to kind of forget about how many people are dying because of these diseases, right? Like if you compare it to like 9/11 or something like that, like the scale is totally different. But sometimes, okay, something happens, pandemic comes along, or the chance at a pandemic, and then we have it fresh in our memory, and then we make these movies, right? So Contagion is actually basically the movie about what if the swine flu had actually happened. And Outbreak is a movie that came out right after, or sort of in the decade after, that there had been some cases of these Ebola and Marburg virus type outbreaks, which had been very small, but all of a sudden this was like, okay, this is something that can actually happen.
Right, and it captured, like, it was all over the news everywhere in the world. Like, you saw the picture of the virus that they had. It's something that I read in the papers.
Yeah.
Also.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, because it's like magic. It's very scary. You can't protect yourself in any way. And I saw something interesting as I was watching Contagion. There was a scene when Laurence Fishburne is talking to his wife, or soon-to-be wife, and he's trying to tell her,
I want you to get in your car and leave Chicago. I want you to drive here to Atlanta. Drive by yourself.
And stay away from other people. Understand? Keep your distance from other people now.
Just like this line, it's also like... l'enfer c'est les autres. Mm-hmm. Other people are hell. Mm-hmm. Just like everybody else is a danger to you. And you see that in Contagion. You have Matt Damon and his daughter, and obviously he's protecting her because of actual realistic and rational health reasons. But underneath that, like the dad with the shotgun, not wanting his daughter to have sex with another man and contract maybe a fetus or something. So there's a lot of like psychological, personal and social psychological stuff going on when other people are the danger just by existing.
Mm-hmm. First of all, I commend you and love you for throwing in the French existentialists. Hell is other people, as Sartre. You also have a podcast about Camus, right, the other day. And actually, we'll come back to the existentialists in the bonus movie.
Okay.
But yeah, because the diseases are so hard to understand for us, all these movies put them in a kind of moralizing setting to some extent, right? So the patient's zero. They're kind of bad people, right? Like Gwyneth Paltrow was kind of fucking around on her layover in London.
I checked the flights and I can actually get an earlier flight that would give me a 5-hour layover and let me know if that's something that you'd like me to do.
There was like some weird subplots, but that had to be put in there that she wasn't like without blame, so she was kind of bad.
And also her kid that died, that wasn't Matt Damon's kid, right? He was like a stepson. Why did they put him as a stepson? That was annoying. Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
But in all these movies, right? Also, of course, in Outbreak with the illegal trafficking of the animals, of course, with the HIV. There's all this, it's the gay plague and the punishment for sodomy. And actually also with the Black Death. So there's all these sort of, like, it's a punishment, right?
Yeah. That is in all to find a reason in this arbitrary thing.
Yeah. There's these common themes in all of them. There's also these miracle cures in basically all of them.
This is forsythia. I've been taking it since the onset of the symptoms.
There's also the point about how the people moving around is a threat, right? Like, it's...
Okay.
You know, it's the Haitians coming in. It's, I guess, the Koreans in Outbreak and in Contagion. It's traveling to China. And it's basically always the dirty foreigners, right? There's a sub theme there as well. Like, it's diseases that first appear in people that aren't as important because they're not Americans and they're maybe not even white. And then it comes closer and closer because of this free movement of people. And oh my God, we have to go in lockdown because this is dangerous.
Build a wall. Stop Schengen.
Yeah.
No Schengen.
No Schengen. No, no, thank you, please.
Yeah. Order is sealed. The governor has declared a quarantine. Get back in your car or I will be dating you.
Okay, so the moralizing is interesting. I think it's kind of missing in the movie, like me, because I'm vegan and I've read about how the animal industry is putting us in danger also for these diseases because of the bad sanitary conditions of the animals, close proximity, all kinds of animals. Also animals eating food that they're not supposed to eat, eating also other processed animals and stuff like that, which is what was the case also in Contagion. But they're like, it ends as... We don't know why it happened, and we'll just move on. Yeah. That's it. They're like, no, we know why it happened. Yeah. You showed us. Tell us what it means.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah, true.
So there was also a big difference between these two movies, that the 1993 Outbreak, the bad guys, this is basically just like Armageddon. It's like the evil government trying to do something. And there's a guy that has to follow orders. He can be on a plane or on an asteroid. And they're telling him, no, don't follow the orders. You be an individual. Think for yourself. Use common sense.
Yeah. Oh, you're right. Yeah, it is. It right, is basically, the guy, it's the Dr. Strangelove plot with like the crazy general who wants to set off the bomb.
Boom.
Totally.
Boom.
Yep.
And then in 2011, it's like more nuanced. There's like a profit motives also in that. Like if today they would do a new Outbreak movie, the villains would be corporations, not the government, I think.
Yeah.
Because of the local, whatever, the current climate.
Yeah, and that was actually in Contagion as well, right? So also the Forsythia miracle cure trades and these investors.
That was good.
Yeah, that was
good. Prescient. That was prescient, right?
Yeah.
Jude Law, just I want to fucking kick him in the face every time I see his face.
He said also right at the beginning, oh, fringe media is dying. And at the time of the movie, it was going to be replaced by blogging.
Blogging is not writing. It's graffiti with punctuation.
I guess blogging is a bit morphed into podcasting.
Yeah. And tweeting.
And YouTubing, and the social media. And he was an early influencer on a specific theme, sort of alternative medicine, I guess.
And he was into fake news. He was fake news before there was fake news.
Yeah, and I thought that was nicely done, that he was, in the end, the bad guy. Because at first you think, oh, he's the intrepid, you know, anti-establishment guy who uncovers. No, he's actually the bad dude. And I thought that was nicely done.
Forsythia is a lie. It's a lie, and you made $4.5 million for telling it. You want to blog about that?
And I thought also, so there's a swipe at those kind of people, another swipe at those kind of people, is that Gwyneth Paltrow doesn't make it, right? Like she has this a magazine called Goop, where they do all this weird witch doctor kind of stuff, these special treatments with the essential oils and this and that, and none of that helps.
Instead of going up to Matt Damon and telling him we have to consciously uncouple, she just went behind his back. That was like a thing that she wrote, you remember?
Yeah, consciously uncoupling.
Conscious uncoupling, But about the fake news guy, that was very consistent, because even at the end, when they told him, we're going to shame you now, basically telling everybody.
You never had the virus. You have no antibodies. You lied.
Of course, that's what your labs say.
So this is like you can never get to the end of the fake news trolls.
Yeah.
You can never get to the end and catch them in the act. They can always, whatever.
Yeah, or 9/11 truthers or flat earth theorists or whatever. They have an answer to everything.
Right? Yeah. So how about the, I wanted to ask you, fact-checking, when it became airborne in Outbreak?
This is a different strain. They look the same, but see the differences?
Yeah, the spikes here and here.
Yes.
Is that realistic that just like that it can become...
No. That was some of the Deus Ex Machina things. Like, we have to like up the ante now. First it was transmission by blood. Okay, well, then just avoid exchanging fluids.
Yeah.
Case closed, right?
Yeah.
But no. It's gone airborne, right? So we have to go one level up. It doesn't evolve that quickly. And like viruses that spread through these fluids, they are in different parts of the body. It doesn't work that way. Oh, and that they then see on the microscope, oh yeah, it's gone airborne, and you can actually see because the filaments have little extra filaments.
No, it's not that.
No.
Oh, another thing I forgot about Jude Law, that was in stark contrast with the Outbreak, where they cut off the phones of this town, and that's it. There's no information. This was like so dated, like... They can't also find out what's going on in their town. There's no internet. There's nothing. They're like, okay, so we'll just stay here. Yeah. Nobody will get information. That's it. And in 2011, you can't stop the spread of of news, real news and fake news, and it brings society to a halt, basically, like a polite, decent society.
Yeah. That's actually a little bit in all these movies, right? Another thing that they like to show is kind of this collapse of the social order with the looting and with just people started to do crazy things to each other.
When they were going to bomb the town, one of the lines that they used, that this Dustin Hoffman used to get the pilot to miss, was that
these people are Americans.
You can bomb other people.
Yeah, that goes without saying. If it's a wedding party or whatever, drop the airburst. Let's go.
But these people are Americans. Yeah. Americans.
Then you have to think a bit more carefully. It's a fair point. No.
Yeah. What about all these doctors in Outbreak being also pilots and soldiers and knowing all kinds of stuff how to do? Is that, do you find that realistic?
Well, I guess the difference between Outbreak and Contagion is that in Outbreak, the doctors are from USMRID, right? So it's like a defense organization that is more about how the US military needs to be prepared against infectious diseases. And in Contagion, it's the CDC.
Okay. So Dustin Hoffman is not with the CDC.
No, no. He is actually a military guy.
So the CDC, that's
Centers for Disease Control. Actually, I have a kind of an interlude. You once upon a time explained that you had been under threat of Hezbollah.
I have.
You have been. And so I can tell you now that I've been...
Digital threat. Go ahead.
Connected to this story, I've been under threat from ISIS.
Okay. Yes. I'll tell the story.
So first of all, it's Somali ISIS, which is also known as Shabab. So Somali ISIS is the way you have like Ajax in Amsterdam and then Ajax Cape Town, so where they like groom the new talents. And so that's Shabab in Somalia.
Like the really good terrorists,
they go global, right?
Yeah, it's like AAA team. It's like for Americans, it's like you have like the major league baseball team, and then you have the AA, AAA, whatever it's called.
Yeah. I went to one of those biosafety level 3 labs in Kenya, on the coast of Kenya, kind of in the north, in 2012 to teach a workshop on how to do this kind of DNA sequence analysis. So actually precisely what they're showing in Contagion.
Okay.
I was teaching at a medical facility there, which is partly of the Kenyan government and partly of the Wellcome Foundation, which is kind of the charity arm of GlaxoSmithKline. So we were staying with like 3 other instructors. We were staying in this resort on the coast, which was totally abandoned, but which looked very fancy, palm trees, Indian Ocean, Amarula drinks by the swimming pool or on the beach. But it was completely abandoned because right at that time, the Kenyan army and the sort of Somali government that was trying to reform itself were mopping up the last Shabab controlled areas in southern Somalia, and actually they still haven't completely succeeded, right? So there's still these areas on the coast where there's these pirates that are sort of jihadists. And the thinking was, well, this is actually kind of a dangerous situation because these guys, they go on these little speedboats along the coast, and what they like to do is kidnap foreigners and then sell them.
Right.
And so at some point also, like, we weren't really privy to the threat reports, but at some point in the resort where we were staying, there was also these local militia guys showing up in the bar to protect us. So there were these dudes with sort of, they had some uniform, but not much. They looked a little irregular, and they had Kalashnikovs and stuff. And they were going to fend off the jihadists should they show up on the beach.
Okay. I thought they were going to double cross you.
No. They seemed very nice. They were also having the same drinks in the bar. I don't think they would have done that much if ISIS had shown up. But they were doing their best.
But it was before ISIS. Before ISIS was really good. So
yeah. And Shabab was still a separate operation, and they later pledged the Legion. Yeah, of course. No judgment. Yeah. I guess one more thing though to connect to this, so like in Outbreak, is that the African doctors are incompetent, and the Westerner has to show up, and do the most basic research and take some samples and then fly back home.
Sam Daniels, your Sam.
Benjamin Mwabi, we've been expecting you.
We came since we could.
Actually, for example, in Kenya, they have very good medical facilities, and they take part in global research just as basically first-class partners. So it's a little patronizing to, but of course, I mean, Africa is a gigantic continent, and then not Africa.
And there was this witch doctor also, right?
Yeah, but it's
Yeah, maybe they're doing. There was this witch doctor on the hill. Maybe he was the.
He's a local juju man, witch doctor. He believes that the gods were awoken from their sleep by the men cutting down the trees where no men should be, and the gods got angry. This is a punishment.
Yeah.
The African stereotype. In Contagion, they talk about the Spanish flu of 1918.
1% of the population died from Spanish flu. It was novel like this. No one had ever seen it before.
1% of America?
1% of the world. As many as 70 million people could die, baby, maybe more.
And I find that probably / obviously because of the First World War, this is such an incredible and important historical event that almost nobody talks about.
Exactly. That was kind of my earlier point, that maybe we try to repress these memories a little bit, because the Spanish flu was a horrendous pandemic.
So tell the people what was it all about.
The Spanish flu was actually the same general strain of flu viruses, H1N1, as the swine flu and as the one that they show in Contagion. And it was a disease that basically started spreading by the end of the First World War, probably with the troop movement, actually, right? So, of course, in wars, people are uprooted, traveling around, and especially in the First World War, which was such a soldier kind of war. And then it started spreading really quickly, and it was a flu variant that for some reason was incredibly deadly. They think that maybe there was some sort of overreaction of the immune system, especially in healthy people. So in like soldiers or sort of, you know, people who are in the prime of their life.
How many people died?
Millions, many millions. Why was it? I don't know. It was like 20 million or something like that.
It's crazy.
That's an insane amount of people. And
after the war.
Yeah.
Like, the war is over. No, let's die now, everybody.
Yeah. Horrific. And there was also this whole collapse of the order, right? Because it was a disease that hit really quickly, basically like what they show in Contagion.
I would say that the most horrible thing of that whole epidemic was that the crisis came so rapidly. The crisis came within the first 2 to 3 hours of your sickness. You either survived or you were dead.
It's not like a flu where you kind of sneeze for a couple of days and then the fever kind of builds up. No, you could be fine in the morning, you could be dead in the evening. And you could just be like coughing up blood and it flies across the room. Apparently that was what the report said. Like in hospitals, there was like blood everywhere because people were dying, just violently coughing themselves to death.
Oh my goodness.
It was horrific, and we forget about it. You know, it's
because we tried to repress, or because it was so close to the war, and the war was more meaningful, that it's just like, okay, so more people died. Okay, whatever.
Probably a little bit of both, I guess. But we don't really want to reflect on, for example, also how lethal flu actually is. Right,
still. Regular flu?
Yeah, just also regular flu every year.
Okay, let's talk about it. If people don't want to talk about it, let's force them to listen.
Well, if there's one take-home message from this podcast, is get your shots, okay? Get your shots for flu, the flu vaccines, And all this bullshit about, oh, there's like a tiny percentage of people that maybe get some side effects from the vaccines. No, if you look at how many thousands of people die from the flu, including people who are not you, but that you could still transmit it to, you should get your shots. You should also get your shots for measles, for all this other stuff. Because these diseases are killers. They really are.
Even flu? Who dies from the flu?
Well, it, most other flu strains are not like the Spanish flu, which wasn't really Spanish at all. Most other flus, it's more either really young children or really old people or maybe people with compromised immune system. Actually, it's called the Spanish flu because Spain was neutral in the First World War. And so they didn't censor the news. So in the Spanish press, they talked about this new disease that was killing young men in the prime of their life at massive numbers. And all the other countries that were at war were not going to hear about this. They just we can't have this on top of everything else. People have to keep moving. People have to die, first of all, in the trenches. And if they also die of this, well, just throw them on the pile. But there's no reporting in the news. So it was censored. So then people who actually had access to the Spanish press thought it was a Spanish disease, which it wasn't. It was just reported in Spain.
Philadelphia. Okay. So AIDS. That was a bummer.
It's a depressing movie. It's also a movie where you're kind of shocked by how... I guess Hollywood wanted to show Denzel Washington as kind of the average American at that time, with the average opinion of, well, gays are dirty and maybe they kind of brought it on themselves. And so actually the words that they put in his mouth are...
Are you a faggot? You know, a punk, queen, pillow biter, fairy, booty snatcher, rump roaster. Are you gay?
Very homophobic. Like, Philadelphia would not have been made in this way right now. But you can see that there's been a clear shift in the acceptance of homosexuality. So, for example, Denzel Washington has to say, like, he can't do it out of, you know, he like some sort of righteous indignation or whatever. So he has to say...
Hey, some of these people make me sick, Phil. But a law's been broken. You remember the law, don't you?
All right, so it's like, I'm not doing it for those, you know, F words, but because the law has been broken.
I think it's also very American. It's like, there's a system, and I don't have to like you in order to protect you. You are an American. They have done something that is against the law. Then I will protect you, even if you are a horrible person. But this horrible person... Okay, so I didn't like Philadelphia. I admit this is the first time that I watched it. I refrained from watching it because I felt it was going to be very, very sad. And I especially didn't like Tom Hanks' performance that gave him the Oscar. I don't know if it's performance, but the character. He was just like perfect.
All right, are you a good lawyer, Andrew?
I'm an excellent lawyer.
What makes you an excellent lawyer?
I love the law. I know the law. I excel at practicing.
What do you love about the law, Andrew?
Many things. What I love the most about the law?
Yes.
Is that every now and again, not often, but occasionally, you get to be a part of justice being done. That really is quite a thrill when that happens.
Always happy, always jolly, always kind, always understanding, always patient, no arc. He was just like the whole time, just a great guy, just a great guy. And why not have like a slightly annoying gay person?
Yeah, but this movie was clearly some kind of outreach project, right? Like, okay, we have to convince the average American that the AIDS pandemic is a real problem and something needs to be done. And so there needs to be kind of a saintly victim of this disease, right? Like, he's kind of an implausible figure in some way as well. Like, okay, he's the perfect lawyer and he's like in the executive lounge smoking his cigars with the rest of the guys. And then like I guess the next scene, he sort of, or like a couple scenes later, he wears like a weird hat, and he kind
of timeline was off.
Like he really changes, like not in his personality, but now he has to look like the AIDS victim, and he like has to wear a silly hat and stuff like that. Like that's it's kind of weird.
Have to wear a silly hat.
Well, and it's so actually kind of a better movie about the early years of the AIDS epidemic is this movie called And the Band Played On, which is actually a bit more political because it really charges at the Reagan administration for not doing enough in the early years.
We have to turn the direction around that we've been going in order to end inflation, end unemployment, and get this country back where it should be in the eyes of the world.
But at year's end, it appears that there will be less money to spend for public health next year.
It took them really a long time before there was sufficient funding, and it was really seen as a problem. But there was also a more realistic depiction of the victims, because of course, the early patients, zeros, or the early people spreading the disease were really, really promiscuous gay dudes. I mean, it's not a lawyer with his boyfriend. It's the guys in the bathhouses and, sniffing the poppers and fucking another dude every night. And they were also, what they also depicted kind of like accurately, or at least honestly, is that from that community there was also like resistance at first to really worry about it, or to for example close the bathhouses or to start using condoms,
which goes to your point, your earlier point about how it really scares us and we don't want to face it.
Yeah, and of course they thought, well, this is all being blown out of proportion because everybody likes the idea that there's like this gay plague or something, and I'm sure it's nothing, and they're just trying to close us down.
This is another Reagan trick to shove us back in the closet.
So that was kind of honestly depicted how it was a bit of a perfect storm, with on the one hand this really conservative US government that really didn't want to act because of their homophobia. And the early sort of gay community in the early 80s, mid-80s, that really didn't want to acknowledge it and didn't want to accept that the party is over. And of course, that then changed a lot. I mean, we've on the sidelines, we've all seen this happen in our youth, I guess, that there was a lot of the, I guess, emancipation of gay communities has been also because of the AIDS epidemic, and like, okay, we need to be accepted and we need not to be, regarded as dirty people or something. And we need to fight this disease together. And it's, I think things such as gay marriage and acceptance of gays has come kind of on the back of that.
You think?
It because they had to make themselves more visible. So, for example, like in Amsterdam in the 90s, there were these benefit parties and things to get more money for AIDS research. And that was all like the gay scene more coming out and being more visible, and because they had to, and I think there's kind of a link to that between the two.
What I was thinking is that the fact that it was viewed as mostly or at first solely a gay plague is also, again, like hell is other people. You have people that look just like us, but they are sick in their mind or sexuality, whatever, that they gay. And you can't tell them apart. And we have to stop the spread of this disease. And then they have an actual disease. And it's just like a double whammy. And I guess that if you don't care for gay people, you're like, okay, let them die if you think that it's going to stay over there. It's such a backwards view. Is the reason that AIDS is no longer such an epidemic because of the frequent use of condoms, or because super mega, mega rich people like Magic Johnson wanted to stay alive? So they put a lot of money in research, and now we know how to curtail it and stop it. When you get HIV, you can live to be 90, from what I know.
if you get treatment, then so the problem with all these viruses is that there are things that evolve in your body. And so even if you have some kind of antiretroviral medication, then over time the virus might evolve immunity to it, and then it breaks out again. And the breakthrough in treating patients with HIV is that they are giving these cocktails. So they give like three different antiretrovirals at one time, and then they monitor like what the viral load is in your body. And then by now, these treatments are so effective that in some cases, it's basically below detection thresholds, more or less. And so if that's the case in you, then of course, you're also much less infectious towards others.
Ah.
So that helps. Okay. I guess condom use has gone up a little bit. I guess also now things like PrEP are coming online.
PrEP?
Yeah, what's PrEP that? Is a medication that prevents the transmission. So this is also, for example, what they give to medical professionals if they are in a situation that might endanger them. So there's that. And then I guess another thing is, at least in, I don't know how it was for you, but you know, I was coming of age.
Sex parties?
Yeah, the sex parties. Yeah. For us, I was, coming of age in the 90s and having my first sexual experiences. And we were made so paranoid by the whole information campaigns, because they, of course, there were also all these public service announcements on the Dutch TV and posters that were hanging everywhere. If you fuck without a condom once and you're screwed, basically. So even in like a small town with heterosex and with basically nobody infected there at all, we thought, oh, you have to really be careful.
Yeah.
And probably good that we did, but it's also, I guess, maybe cramped our style a little bit.
I think that I want to say that about the first two movies and the animal industry. Another reason that these epidemics are so dangerous because of the animal industry is the very frequent and pervasive use of antibiotics in animals, so they don't get diseased because of their horrible conditions, the horrible conditions in which they live. And then we consume their meat or dairy, and then there are viruses that are immune to antibiotics.
Bacteria. Antibiotics not viruses. Bacterial. Yeah.
Ah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. But yeah.
Man, I couldn't stick the landing.
But you're almost there. But it's a big problem. Yeah. It's and they just give antibiotics, not as a specific treatment, but just continuously, and it's not even just to prevent disease, but it also just changes the microbiome of these animals, so they get fatter quicker, basically, right?
Ah, really?
So the antibiotics are everywhere, and so then you get these multi-resistant bacterial strains, which at some point, like, you get a flesh-eating bacteria, and there's basically nothing, none of the antibiotics work anymore, or only a couple of them, really harsh ones or something like that. It's really dumb. It's really really dangerous.
But on the other hand, people like their hamburgers.
Oh, that's important too.
That's also important.
Yeah.
And they have cow's milk in their coffee and not another kind of milk.
Mm.
So I don't know.
No.
I don't know. Let's think about it. Okay, so while we think about it, let's slide over to the last movie, Black Death. So talk about the Black Plague.
They will all die by God's hand. Open my ship. I am Death. Vengeance is mine.
God's fury rains down on you!
So, did you think it was a horror movie now that you watched it? Because it was tagged as horror, but did you agree that it wasn't?
No, it wasn't a horror movie, but I thought it was a shitty movie.
That I agree.
You agree? Because afterwards I read reviews and I read like rave reviews, and I was like, no, this, like, I didn't understand this movie. What was this movie about? It was just like really unclear, and uneven in the pacing and in the way that you get the information. There's this woman, and then the woman died, and then did she die? Did she not die? And the characters that like Ned Stark is there, right? Melisandre is there. Also Stephen Hawking is there. A lot of really interesting people are there.
Well, that part I thought was nice. It was. It was like an episode of Game of Thrones, and there's like, yeah, you're not sure if it's magic or if it's all like staged.
People need miracles, and they worship the miracle makers, whoever they might be.
I thought it was not a good movie.
It was not
all
a good movie, but I was actually, okay, I was trying to actually help you out because... the other movie that I actually wanted to recommend, The Seventh Seal, is a better movie, except it is from the 50s and it's in black and white. So I thought, oh, that's not going to fly.
I know. When I said that it was a shitty movie, I wasn't saying that against you. People don't know that you're the one that mostly does the picking of our movies. It was just like a general comment.
I mostly pick the shitty movies. But they need to touch on the theme. That's the thing, you know.
We needed a movie about Black Death, about the Black Plague, right? Which probably started with the Mongols. That's like one of the theories, right? When they threw over the walls like diseased animals and stuff.
There's a lot of questions about it.
What is the Black Plague, and then what do you think?
So the plague, that is actually a bacterial disease, which is spread by a bacteria called Yersinia pestis.
What's the difference between bacteria and virus? Come on, I feel stupid, but I have to ask it.
Bacteria are living things. They're single-celled organisms, but they are definitely alive. They eat, they might move about, they do cell division and all that stuff. A virus is basically just a bit of DNA, just a code inside a protein envelope. And it's like a bug in the system, almost a virus. Like for some reason, these bits of code appeared that make it so that the hosts replicate that code. And that's what they do. And then the virus just spreads because of the replication machinery. So Yersinia pestis is a bacteria that causes plague, but it can cause it in a couple of different ways. For example, bubonic plague, which is like the one from the Black Death, gets into your lymph nodes, for example, in your groin or in your armpit or in your neck, and it swells up and you die. The classic model is, the plague is this bacteria inside fleas, and normally the fleas sit on rats or other small mammals, and then from the rats, the fleas jump over to people, and then they bite people, and then with the bite, the bacteria are sort of vomited into the bloodstream, and that's how you get it. And so the Mongols, who also come from the steppes, just like the rats and the fleas, they were laying siege to a city on the coast of the Black Sea, and then they had some sick people in their ranks who died, and then they catapulted the bodies into the city. And then from there, ships from the Italian marine city-state spread it throughout the Mediterranean, and then further into Europe. There were areas where they didn't get it quite so quickly, such as in Scandinavia. And then something really dramatic, but supposedly true, happened, was that, along the Norwegian coast, they weren't going to let in any ships because they'd heard about the Black Death and they didn't want to get it. And so, that's kind of very sensible. And so there was a quarantine, and until like 1351 or so, there was no Black Death there. So they held out for like 3 years. And then there was an English ship where everybody aboard the ship died of the plague. So it was a ghost ship.
Okay.
And then the ghost ship landed on the Norwegian shore. And then people went to investigate, like, what's up with this ship? And then they got bit by the fleas, who, of course, were starved by now because everybody else on the ship was dead. And then that's how it spread into Scandinavia. And then the movie The Seventh Seal, that's also a movie with an actor from Game of Thrones, namely with Max von Sydow, who is
Who is he?
He's the Three-Eyed Raven.
The first one or the second one? There was one English one, so not the English one.
No, I guess not the English one.
Okay.
And he plays a knight coming back from the Crusades, and on his way back into Sweden, he sees actually the things that we also kind of touched on in these other movies, that there's this sort of collapse of the order, there's looting, yeah, raping, pillaging, and there's people getting sick, and there's the religious mania, because what we've been doing in this review is that we've been going from the most enlightened and aware movies, where we actually know how these diseases work, and we're relatively not prejudiced, to the complete ignorance in the Middle Ages, where they thought, well, it's whatever, it's a punishment from God, or it's, I don't know.
Yeah, what else could it be?
Yeah.
Can't it be just like some bacteria? What the fuck are you talking about?
I've never heard of bacteria.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting movie. It's pretty well acted, and it's been completely restored by the Svensk film industry, which is the Swedish government organization that promotes their movie making.
You love Sweden. You love everything that is related to Sweden.
I love everything about Sweden.
Everything about Sweden.
Yeah, and so the restoration is actually really good. Like, it's not like in other black and white movies where like it's a bit shaky. Now they digitally stabilized everything, so the shots are really good. The sound quality is very good. And what's interesting about this movie is, of course, it's not really about the Black Death. It's a movie about the 1950s existentialism.
Ah, here we go. Right. You set that up pretty nicely at the beginning of the conversation.
Doing what we need to, everyone is see-through. Stay away from evil, hell is other people. Never try to leave you, slide away like treacle. No one ever keeps you. Hate is never equal.
Yeah, so the knight, the main character, of course, he lands in Sweden on the coast. He sees the mayhem, and then he sees death, the figure death. And the figure of death says, well, look, I'm coming for you now. But then the knight manages to persuade him to play a game of chess. And so long as they're playing chess, he gets to stay alive, and then he gets to ask questions. So then the rest of the movie is, you know, what is actually the good life? What is the, why are we here? Why is all this insanity happening? All the religious insanity. So there's a lot of questioning of the church also.
Is no God.
There's, you know, if this is happening anyway, why not just be merry and live happily and do whatever you like, which was actually kind of also one of these subtexts. Also at the time of the actual time of the Black Death, where people were just sort of going extremely hedonistic because, well, the end is near anyway.
There are reports of that. Yeah, also, I guess a lot of people lost their spouses and children, so you're like, what the fuck?
It's no sin to love a woman.
I've sworn to God.
A man needs more than divine love to sustain him. And he shouldn't be punished for wanting it.
Do you have a husband?
My husband is dead.
I'm sorry.
Take a few pills.
What is maybe a theme in these diseases, if so many people are dying and others are uprooted, they form new groups, the survivors, right? And then they try to live together in new ways. And so, for example, what that led to was also a new kind of storytelling in the Middle Ages. So around the same time, there's two major books that were written. One is the Canterbury Tales, so in English, Geoffrey Chaucer, which is also like 14th century. And the other is De Camerone, which is precisely about a group of people who flee to the countryside to try to avoid the Black Death. And then within that setting, they tell each other stories. And because of the kind of nihilism of the time, there's some like vaguely erotic here and there. And actually that is also a little bit in this movie, The Seventh Seal, which is where the main characters are this group of people who are also traveling through the forest, just like in They Come Alone. And they're also questioning what's happening. In the end, I guess the conclusion is, well, all that really matters is the love between a man and a woman, or a little family unit, and just being happy together, and like the church and fighting in the Crusades and moralizing and all that other stuff doesn't matter, and life is meaningless otherwise.
Oh, it's a shame that they forgot about it afterwards. Yeah. But so An interesting thing. So now I want to bring back Contagion. So when there's such a crisis, so society inevitably changes. We mentioned that a few times, I think, also in one of our last podcasts about Robin Hood. We can elaborate in a moment. When you have a third of the population that dies, inevitably you're going to have some very significant and meaningful social changes. Mm-hmm. And we see in Contagion the hints of a more equitable and equal society in the way that they distribute the vaccine. Mm-hmm. It's like a total lottery. You can be the doctor that works in the whatever in the CDC, or just a guy. It doesn't matter. It's a total lottery.
The next citizens to receive the MEV1 vaccination are those born on the date January 11th.
I read yesterday about a proposed system of government representation that is totally arbitrary, the lottery. And apparently it used to work in ancient Greece and stuff, where you just like take a few people for this committee, that committee, this committee. And apparently we don't know if it can work in millions and millions of people, but there's something that is very relaxing to society when there's a chance in it and you don't have to earn it and fight for it, whatever. I'm digressing a little bit, but so in Contagion it changed society in that way. How did it change society? How did the Black Plague change the European society in 30 seconds, please, Stamkin?
The European society was, of course, a pyramid of feudalism with the lords and the dukes and the counts or whatever at the top and all the peasants at the bottom. But in the aftermath of the Black Death, the people at the top had to come to terms with the fact that they need those people at the bottom to work the land. And so there's a bunch
also,
of different...
they also died. Also, the people at the top, a lot of them died. So you're not more special than anybody else.
Oh, yeah, no. In terms of like the way people viewed life, there was this whole memento mori, like we're all going to die. We're all in this dance of death. No matter the Pope or the peasants, you're all going to go. Yeah. And so that was very, in terms of people's mentality, that was very, I guess, healthy in some way. But in terms of the social order, that also really changed in multiple ways. And one way is that in some areas, the peasants could kind of negotiate better conditions, you know, slightly less mud in their face. I don't know. not covered in shit all the time.
Help! Help! I'm being repressed, bloody peasant! Oh, what a giveaway. Did you hear that? Did you hear that, eh?
But it also, for example, changed agriculture. Like in other areas that were kind of depopulated, what the lords started doing was have more, not intensive, but extensive agriculture, like having, for example, sheep and just grazing instead of agriculture. So that's kind of also where that kind of great flocks of sheep of the lords for the wool industry kind of started. It also led to more freedom for some people because they were less under the constraints of this system which had broken down. And maybe that kind of set the stage also for the Renaissance in some ways, right? In the sense that the mentality had changed a little and the social order had been changed in a way that there was a bit more mobility so that you could
and
have
the
these
church
kind of...
didn't prove itself that it has all the answers and knows how to solve all the problems.
Right,
obviously.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, so actually that set the stage for something that's going to be part of our next or future podcast where we talk a little bit about finance. I think.
Ooh, yes.
And the beginnings of finance is in these same Renaissance city states where all of a sudden just normal people, not nobility or anything, started to have money, power, influence, and started to commission their own art. And I have actually been rewatching the Medici series, and I actually enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah, I watched like 3-4 episodes. Maybe I'm going to give it another chance. Yeah. But so I wanted to ask you. So in Outbreak, they find a vaccine. In Contagion, they find a vaccine. How did the Spanish flu, how did the Black Plague end? Why isn't everybody dead? That's what I want to know. Why are people still alive?
Why are we here? Well, the Black Death didn't really end. But yeah, these things kind of go in waves. But in fact, there had been outbreaks up until the 19th century or so. It kept coming back. But the first wave was such a what we call selective sweep, which is, you know, something horrific happened.
You and I,
we evolutionary biologists. some disaster happens, and there's like a massive filter that only people who have, for example, some natural immunity against the disease get through. And there's actually some evidence that European populations after the Black Death had just different gene frequencies for some genes that confer some natural immunity. And the story is actually even more interesting in that they could show in the European Roma, or people who are sometimes erroneously referred to as gypsies, which is not the right term to use. They came to Europe, to Eastern Europe, firstly, from Northern India in the Middle Ages. And they were, and still are, a community that is very, like, not really intermarrying with Europeans. And so they were isolated from the Europeans. And in both these populations, there's been sort of parallel evolution where the same types of immunity have evolved because of the selective pressure of the Black Death. So it's kind of neat that both populations...
Without intermarrying, without mixing their genes.
Yeah, so they independently evolved this immunity. So that's one of the reasons. Another reason is that these diseases, especially viruses...
Three mutation, right?
Yeah. And maybe, you know, maybe it was already present at very low frequency in the population, right? But then, of course, if everybody around you dies and you don't, well, then your frequency goes up.
Yeah, good for you.
Yeah, good for you. You can rule over the bodies. But especially, like, it's not to the same extent in bacteria, but also kind of, but especially in viruses, they evolve very rapidly. And so, for example, the Spanish flu evolves, and that strain is just no longer really around. And of course, also medical care has improved. We now know that actually that strain, you can contain it reasonably well with Tamiflu, which was the thing that people were hoarding when the swine flu broke out a couple of years ago. I still have a stash, I think, in my house. My dad knew a guy. So we bought a bunch of these strips of Tamiflu in the case society was going to collapse. I think they're out of date now, though.
Before taking Tamiflu, tell your doctor if you're pregnant, nursing, have serious health conditions, or take other medicines. If you develop an allergic reaction, a severe rash, or signs of unusual behavior, stop taking Tamiflu and call your doctor immediately. Children and adolescents in particular may be at an increased risk of seizures, confusion, or abnormal behavior. The most common side effects are mild to moderate nausea and vomiting. The flu comes on fast, so ask your doctor about Tamiflu. Prescription for flu.
Okay, so Rutger, let's wrap it up. Let's wrap it up. As usual, it's been very interesting. We learned a lot, and we will forget it all because we want to be optimistic and happy. No, stay away. Can it go through the airwaves, the internet?
Digital viruses, yeah, computer viruses.
You know, I remember the first time that there was the first digital virus. I remember watching it on TV, eating on Friday the 13th, and people were like, what the fuck was that? Until later they realized that just that was code.
Yeah.
So next up, we're going to do banking or finance in movies. It's going to be history in movies podcast.
Yeah, I look forward to that as well. That's going to be fun.
Yes. A lot has changed.
Which ones were we going to watch?
Mary Poppins.
The Wolf of Wall Street. Yeah,
The Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah, that was fun.
And Wall Street.
Oh, yeah, good. Yeah, sure.
The Merchant of Venice.
The Merchant of Venice, yeah. And I guess I'm going to weave in the Medici a little bit as well.
Okay, so maybe I'll watch the Medici also a little bit just to see what's what. Yeah. And if you enjoy this podcast you should follow it. Click the follow button just to make sure that you don't miss any of our podcasts, and you can go back in time and listen to our podcasts about, we did a really, really good one about Robin Hood. It was during the summer, so maybe you were on vacation or whatever. Mm-hmm. And we, what was our last science one? It was about natural disasters.
Oh, that one was good too.
Yeah, yeah, they're all good. The history and science ones, you can go back and listen to them all. And if you want to make sure that we will keep doing this, then you can consider going on to patreon.com/gotacademy and just like buying me a cup of coffee per month, one cup of coffee, $2 per month, that's it. It will go a long way. Yeah. So thank you in advance for you doing that. You, I'm talking about you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just do it now. Just do it now, right now. Not like
no, but he's driving, and she's also driving. You can, whatever, do it when you get to the office. Mm. But if you're on the
pull over now.
But you guys that are on the train, do it now. The link is in the description. Patreon.com/GotAcademy, and we have a nice little community there. And we comment and explain. Also, so speaking about that, Rutger, Mallory asked you a question about...
I guess we...
Our last podcast.
I got to check on that. But she was also talking like maybe we could do another project like, together or the three of us or whatever.
No, not that. She asked a question about like a science question.
Oh, okay. I'll check it out.
I'll send you the link to that. So thank you everybody for tuning in, and we'll see you all next time. Bye everyone.
I get a fever that's so hard to bear. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me